Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to my lecture recital on Cécile Chaminade. Thank you all so much for being here today. She was a French Romantic woman composer who was active in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. I first learned about Chaminade by hearing one of her works performed in Paris a few years ago, which was coincidentally where she lived for a good part of her life. I was drawn towards her composing style and became interested in learning more about her story. So, I really hope that you all enjoy my upcoming presentation. Without further ado, let's begin. Cécile Louise Stephanie Chaminade was born on August 8, 1857 in Paris. Her exact birth year was disputed for some time due to the vast majority of her writings listing 1861 instead. It has been speculated that this was done for her to maintain a profit from her youthful appearance. She was raised in a musical family as the third of six children. Both of her parents were musicians, as her father was a violinist, and her mother was a pianist and singer. For the majority of the year, the family resided in Paris, but would spend some time vacationing in Les Maisonnées, a village west of Paris. This residence became a place of comfort and refuge for Chaminade, who would eventually make it her year-round home beginning in the 1890s. Today, a street bears her name in honor of the time that she spent there. Chaminade showed great promise from a young age in her musical endeavors, both in piano, where her first lessons came from her mother, and in composing. Her earliest documented experiments with composing came from the mid-1860s, with some pieces written as young as age seven. She used her cats, dogs, parrots, and even dolls as inspiration for these short works. At some point between 1867 to 68, Chaminade was assessed by Félix Lécoupé of the Paris Conservatory, who was a French music teacher, pianist, and composer. He recommended that she study music at the conservatory, but her father was firmly opposed due to his view that it was improper for someone of her class. He did, however, allow her to study privately with several of the faculty. Chaminade took piano lessons with Lécoupé and Marmontel, violin from Marzic, counterpoint from Savard, and composition lessons from Benjamin Godard. Several of these teachers had also taught famous names such as Georges Bizet, Claude Debussy, Jules Massenet, and Edward McDowell. And speaking of Bizet, a young Chaminade performed some of her music for him in 1869, which he admired, and they were reported to have stayed in touch. She was present at the premiere of his now famous opera Carmen in 1875, where the harsh critical response to the opera likely led to his untimely death that same year. This left a lasting impression on her all throughout her life. She was also rumored to have played for Liszt at some point in the 1860s, who compared her style to that of Chopin's. So I listed a bunch of composers. I just wanted to include a few names that were active around the time Chaminade was alive. Of course, this is not a comprehensive list, but this is just a few of the composers that kind of surrounded her. So, moving on now, into the public eye. The Franco-Prussian War of 1870 briefly interrupted Chaminade's musical studies, but aside from this, her skills continued to develop, and she eventually made her professional playing debut in Paris in the year 1877. However, her true introduction of her compositional talents came from a private recital in 1878. Where Chaminade performed only her own works, which was widely reviewed and well-received. This recital marked the beginning of her emergence as a composer, and also served as a model for typical recitals of hers in the decades to come, which was a mix of piano solos and song repertoire already performed by the composer herself. As Chaminade's star began to rise, she performed in public on a regular basis, either in chamber concerts with her teacher Marsic and other friends, or in solo recitals featuring her compositions. During this time, several of her works were also programmed by the prestigious National Society of Music, which was an organization in late 19th and early 20th century Paris that promoted works of rising French composers to the public. In 1882, she directed a private performance of her comic opera, Les Sabillons, at her parents' residence in Paris. And in 1888, her full-length symphonic ballet, Cailleiro, was premiered in Marseille to widespread success. In fact, one of her arguably most well-known compositions today, the solo piano from this suite. 1888 was productive for Chaminade in numerous other ways, as she composed her Concertstück, which ended up being her only piece for piano and orchestra, as well as Les Amazones, which was her only symphony. However, upon entering the 1890s, there was a marked change in Chaminade's compositions, which could possibly be linked to her father's death and thus a loss of financial security in her family. She mostly stopped composing large form works, so operas, concertos, chamber music, and almost exclusively cultivated her collection of smaller, more marketable genres of solo piano pieces and songs. The only exception was the concertino for flute and orchestra, which was written in 1902 due to a commissioned request from the conservatory. At the same time, Chaminade began to tour extensively throughout Europe, concertizing in various music hubs such as Berlin, Vienna, Geneva, and London. She was especially popular in England, where Queen Victoria invited her to perform private concerts on several occasions at the Windsor Castle. She was presented with a Jubilee Medal and a signed photograph from the Queen, which was a significant honor. Chaminade's personal life underwent a significant change in 1901 when she married the Marseille-based music publisher, Louis Mathieu Carbonell. The terms of this engagement were unusual, though, as both planned to reside in their former homes and only see each other periodically. Because of this, and because Carbonell was more than 20 years her senior, it has been suspected that this marriage was one arranged for convenience so that Chaminade could preserve her professional independence. It only lasted for a few years regardless, as Carbonell passed away in 1907. After this, Chaminade finally accepted a long-standing invitation to tour through the United States and performed in several cities such as New York, Chicago, Philadelphia, Boston, and more in 1908. She was even invited to meet the U.S. President of the time, Theodore Roosevelt, at the White House. The tour was a huge financial success, halls were regularly filled to capacity, and there were consistent reports of hundreds of people being turned away at the doors. Upon her return to France, information about Chaminade's activities began to wane. The breakout of World War I caused tremendous disruption to her creative output. The last notable record within this time period came in 1913, when the French government awarded her the Legion of Honor, which is the highest honor of this nature, making her the first female composer ever to be honored this way. After this, though, Chaminade largely faded from the public eye, compounded by a series of health issues rendering her largely immobile in the final years of her life. She moved to Monte Carlo in 1936 and died on April 13, 1944 at the age of 86. Her last recorded publication was issued in 1928, although a few unpublished works were discovered that were likely written in this final period. So, all in all, Chaminade's complete compositional output consists of over 400 works, largely dominated by solo piano pieces and songs, but also consisting of duets, orchestral suites, ballet music, organ music, and more. Her most defining feature was characterized by appealing tuneful melodies, which unfold in a regular phrase structure, most often ternary. So-called feminine traits, such as grace and charm, were often linked to her style. Audiences seem to have enjoyed the titles and subjects of her character pieces, which ranged from topics covering Greek myth, domestic scenes, nature, and religious ceremonies. The variety of locations and situations allowed audience members to embark on an oral tour of places not as easily visited in person. Chaminade's works also appeal to a wide range of performers. For example, some pieces like the Romance Sans Paroles, Opus 76, mimic the tradition of Mendelssohn's Song Without Words. Excuse me. Song Without Words, while others reflected the legacy of Chopin through mood and elegant melody, like the Nocturne or Barcarolle. Some collections were designed for a seasoned professional. For example, the Six Concert Etudes, Opus 35, or the Toccata, Opus 39. While other albums were written for children, like her two albums Des Enfants, Opus 123 and Opus 126. The majority of her pieces lay somewhere in between at varying levels of expertise. The Ladies' Home Journal in 1907 featured an article by Chaminade titled How to Plan My Compositions, which I've included on my slide here. In this article, she compiled a ranked list of her popular works by difficulty and recommendations for different levels of experience. We will take a closer look at some of her works later on in my lecture. So, Chaminade's compositional voice is majorly representative of the French Romantic tradition in her youth, a time where Saint-Saëns was at his peak, and the most progressive composers, such as Wagner, were just starting to explore the potential of the chromatic scale. In spite of her international renown, she continued to find herself marginalized by the Parisian music world, enjoying more success in the surrounding provinces. Additionally, Chaminade's voice did not evolve much over her lifetime, and through the gradual shift into Impressionism and early modern eras, her compositions slowly became outdated and behind the times. By World War I, her music was considered part of the outmoded parlor tradition and considered passé in comparison to the more progressive compositions of Debussy or Ravel. Since Chaminade never made much of an effort to shift with the times, there's also no distinction between an early or late Chaminade style. We are fortunate to have some insight into Chaminade's inner thoughts through a collection of articles she penned for the Etude Journal, an American print magazine dedicated to music. One of these articles, which was titled Recollections of My Musical Childhood, was published in December of 1911. Here, she discusses her methods of composing. I developed the habit of composing by preference in the evening, and succeeding years have strengthened the habit. The surroundings of nature are indispensable for me for creative work, whether it be near the sea, forest, plain, or mountain. I do not like big cities and cannot work in them. I can only work when everything is peaceful and quiet around me. This appears to be a kind of natural shyness which I cannot conquer. My most intimate pleasures are those that can be enjoyed in silence. She was a true extrovert, I guess. Reflecting upon this quote, it stands to reason that Chaminade's fondest memories of her childhood occurred at their residence in Vézinhan, and that she retreated back there every chance she had amidst her concert touring. Further records indicate that she preferred staying close to home in the company of her mother and her close friends, not willing to attend social events she was invited to if there was no performance aspect involved. One final interesting detail lies in her general sense of performance anxiety. Multiple sources have indicated that Chaminade felt that every performance she gave would be her last one, owing to extreme nervousness. I cannot play before so many people ever again, which is what she said after every concert, which is a feeling I am sure many of us can probably relate to. However, she continued her concert tours, although the vast majority of her performances were done privately, away from the spotlight and away from the harsh condemnations of music critics. So, speaking along those lines, let's take a moment to consider Cécile Chaminade's career as a musician and composer through the lens of her gender. How much of her activities were informed or affected by the simple nature of her existence? To start, her father did not permit her to officially study at the Paris Conservatory due to it being improper for someone of her class. However, she was still able to receive private lessons from teachers in numerous subjects, so it is difficult to measure the extent to which she was affected. At minimum, she was not able to interact with other students and musicians, which limited her contacts for the future. An unusual facet of Chaminade's career was that she had hundreds of works published under her own name in her lifetime. After her father passed away, she and her mother had limited financial reserves to draw upon, and performing her own compositions in public was considered a socially acceptable method of earning a living. This may have contributed to her desire to continue composing and performing, as this would increase revenue from the sale of music. After all, new pieces were composed for performances, and these performances would in turn generate more sales. This can be contrasted with the experience of Fanny Mendelssohn, whose compositions existed solely within her private circles until the final year of her life, when she managed to publish a small collection of works as her first booklets. Several of Fanny Mendelssohn's works had also previously been published under the name of her brother, Felix. Chaminade enjoyed periods of great success in her lifetime, particularly in the middle decades of her activity. She was particularly popular in France, which was her homeland, England, and in the United States, where the formation of hundreds of Chaminade clubs, along with numerous tour invitations, provided a glimpse into the impact she had as a composer. The Chaminade clubs, in particular, were formed and consisted almost entirely of women, and although they did not necessarily perform her repertoire exclusively, it served as a recognition of her popularity and renown. On the slide, an example is shown of the anagram motto that the Chaminade Club in Brooklyn, New York, sent her in 1923. So they spelled out her name, Chaminade, and each letter stands for something different. So C, concentrated and concerted effort. H, harmony of spirit and work. A is artistic ideals. M is musical merit maintained. I for inspiration. Notes, every kind except promissory notes. So no lending money. Ardor and aspiration was A. D is devotion to duty. And E is earnest endeavor. What is that spell? It spells Chaminade, just in case you didn't see that up there. However, there were as many negative critics as positive ones, with many decrying her music as salon music, suggesting her pieces were artistic and sentimental, but overall filled with empty, virtuosic flourishes that were best kept within homes for the private enjoyment of women. There are quotes where her music is referred to as amazingly superficial and wanting in variety. This was a review of her Carnegie Hall concert from October 1908. Indeed, a great deal of music criticism during Chaminade's lifetime was marked by masculine or feminine attributes. While her character pieces were dismissed for their femininity, her concert works were criticized as being fraudulently masculine. Compare this reception to the response for Chopin's more sentimental pieces. Critics stated those were only but one facet of his compositional genius and could be appreciated along with the rest of his works. However, Chaminade did have her supporters. One of the most well-known quotes about her is attributed to Envoi Thomas in the early 1880s, where he declares that this is not a woman who composes, but a composer who is a woman. Finally, as mentioned earlier, Chaminade's decision to enter into a marriage that may or may not have been for convenience, may not have been necessary, had it not been for societal expectations of the time. Many male composers navigated through life unattached, but for Chaminade, about 6 years of her life were spent in this unfamiliar chapter, and her family was reportedly of the belief that this marriage caused her to sacrifice professional momentum and precious creative years while she was caring for her husband's declining health. As to Chaminade's thoughts on the matter, she is quoted as saying, among other reflections, that I do not believe that the few women who have achieved greatness in creative work are the exception. But I do think that life has been hard on women. It is impossible to measure how much Chaminade's success or struggle was related to her being a woman. However, it is undeniable that it was quite difficult to break into the Parisian musical world, and a wide variety of considerations had to be thought out in order for her to have any chance of being taken seriously. So at this time, I'd like to take a brief break and listen to one small excerpt of Chaminade's Scarf Dance, which, as I mentioned before, is one of her most well-known works. Although I did not end up putting it on my program today, I'd still like for you all to have the chance to hear just a little bit of it. But not the ad. Give me 1 second.
Thank you.
probably most famously known work of this era. And I also wanted to include, and this might pop up as an ad again, it didn't, yay. This is a recording of Chaminade herself actually performing this piece. So I'll just play it a little bit so you can hear if there are any differences. Here on the slide, and also in your individual programs. As a quick note, when planning my program, I had a great deal of trouble because Chaminade has written so many extraordinary pieces, and there were only so many that I could include on one program, but I wanted to highlight all of them. So I chose to include her one and only piano sonata as a representation of a more serious body of her work. I then programmed the Autumn Etude and the Flatterer, both of which are considered some of her most popular and well-known pieces throughout and after her lifetime. Finally, I wanted to choose a piece that represents her later publications, so I opted for the Caprice-Impromptu, a work that I came across completely by chance, because there's absolutely no reference information available, but I was lucky to have found it. So in the next few slides, I'm going to go over each of these pieces in a bit more detail. First, I'd like to discuss Chaminade's Piano Sonata, which, as I mentioned before, is her only work of this nature. This piece was officially published in 1895, but given its earlier opus number, the true date of composition is uncertain. The piece is dedicated to Moritz Mozgowski, a well-known Polish-German composer who also happened to marry Chaminade's younger sister in 1886. Fun fact. It is likely that due to this dedication, it contains some of his influence. Stylistically, it is arguably her most Germanic piano piece. However, perhaps due to its more involved nature, Chaminade rarely ever programmed it on her concerts. The piece consists of three movements. The first and third are very dramatic and fiery with significant technical challenges, while the second is introspective and profound in nature. An interesting note is that the third movement of this sonata is, note for note, the exact same piece as Chaminade's fourth concert etude in the Opus 35 set. If you take a look on the slide, even though they are two separate publications, there's been absolutely nothing changed between both of the versions. Given the later publication date, it is most likely that she chose to republish the etude as the sonata's third movement, although the reasoning behind this is not known. This gives me the perfect segue into the next piece on my program, which is the Autumn Etude, the second concert etude out of the six in Opus 35. This etude is by far the most well-known. In fact, although the Scarf Dance was the most popular Chaminade work in the United States, the Autumn Etude likely possessed this distinction on the international level. An example, in the 1930s, a recording of this piece was noted to have sold 21,000 copies in just a three-year period. The style of this piece, which is written in a ternary form, has been compared to that of Chabrier, a French contemporary and friend of Chaminade's. It displays the beautiful song-like melody for the main theme that she was known for in all of her compositions. I zoomed in a little bit on the screen so you can see the first part of this piece a little more clearly. Something that Chaminade was well known for doing is making the notes of her melody line bigger, and for all of the other accompanying features, those notes were printed a bit smaller, as you can see in the top line. Chaminade performed this piece quite often on her concert tours, and even made a dual art piano roll recording in the early 1910s. I've linked the recording here appear on the slide, which, by the way, I didn't mention before, but you can access the slide through the QR code on your program. But I will not play it now so that I don't set myself up for comparison when I have to perform it later on. The third piece on my program is titled Lisonjera, Opus 50, which translates to The Flatterer. This piece was published in 1890 by the Italian publishing company Ricordi, and was subsequently widely released in the United States. The title is derived from the Spanish feminine noun lisonjera, which suggests a combination of charming, coaxing, and beguiling virtues with just a hint of deception. The feminine connotation of the title suggests that Chaminade was writing with the idea of the modern woman in mind, one who was more daring and forward in their approaches, compared to the more traditional woman of the time period who would be passive and reserved. Although a vast majority of Chaminade's pieces have French titles, this one is Spanish, possibly due to the Spanish influence sweeping through 19th century French music at the time. So think about, for example, Bizet's Carmen in 1875, Debussy's Iberia in the early 1900s, Chabrier's España in 1883, or Ravel's Bolero in 1928. Technique elements utilized in this piece include voicing the melodic line while accompanying notes in the chords are struck simultaneously. The presence of the syncopation on the downbeat creates a non-harmonic dissonance that quickly resolves to the tonic chord, furthering the feeling of temptation and adventure. The performance direction is listed as molto capriccioso, which loosely translates to willful indulgence. In the December 1908 issue of the Etude magazine, which I included a screenshot of, but unfortunately is very blurry because it is from 1908, Chaminade personally pens a suggestion as to how this work should be performed. She says that it is easy enough to play, but very difficult to interpret. Here the composer has to count more than ever on the intuition and musical tact of the performer, for it is nearly impossible to indicate very clearly the humorous allurement and rhythmic quality of this little piece. Although the main theme returns three times in total, with the form being A-V-A-V-A, each repetition brings a new sense of discovery and wonder. I've also linked Chaminade's performance of this piece on the bottom of the slides for you to look at later. The final piece on the program is the Caprice-Impromptu, Opus 153. Other than the publication date, which is 1914, there are absolutely no resources containing information about this piece. The only details we can infer is that this piece was published 1 year after Chaminade received the Legion of Honor from the French government. While she was still very much known, the music world was beginning to move in new directions, which might explain the lack of publicity for some of her compositions in this era. The Caprice-Impromptu is vivacious, spirited, and at times explosive, with a boldly breathtaking theme alternating with occasional moments of gorgeous lyricism. It was the perfect showpiece with which to conclude my program today. Speaking of which, we have finally reached the conclusion of my lecture on Chaminade. As a bonus, I've included here a small list of my personal favorites of her compositions that I was unable to include on today's recital. So if you're so inspired to listen to more of her works and develop a deeper understanding and connection with her compositions, I would highly suggest that you check some of these out. So with that, thank you all so much for your attention and for being here. There will now be a brief intermission, after which our journey together through Chaminade's pieces will begin. Thank you again.